Imagine a company where people love coming to work and are highly productive on a daily basis. Imagine a company whose top executives, in a quest to create the most fun workplace ever, obliterate labor management divisions and push decision-making responsibility down to the plant floor. Could such a company compete in today's bottom-line corporate world? Could it even turn a profit? Well, imagine no more. In Joy at Work, Dennis Bakke tells the true story of this extraordinary company and how, as its co-founder and longtime CEO, he challenged the business establishment with revolutionary ideas that could remake America's organizations. It is the story of AES, whose business model and operating ethos, Let's Have Fun, were conceived during a 90-minute car ride from Annapolis, Maryland to Washington, D.C. In the next two decades, it became a worldwide energy giant with 40,000 employees in 31 countries and revenues of $8.6 billion. It's a remarkable tale told by a remarkable man. Bakke was a farm boy who was shaped by his religious faith, his years at Harvard Business School, and his experience working for the Federal Energy Administration. He rejected workplace drudgery as a noxious remnant of the Industrial Revolution. He believes work should be fun, and at AES, he set out to prove it could be. Bakke sought not the empty fun of the Friday beer blast, but the joy of a workplace where every person, from custodian to CEO, has the power to use his or her God-given talents free of needless corporate bureaucracy. In Joy at Work, Bakke tells how he helped create a company where every decision made at the top was lamented as a lost chance to delegate responsibility, and where all employees were encouraged to take the game-winning shot, even when it wasn't a slam dunk. Perhaps Bakke's most radical stand was his struggle to break the stranglehold of creating shareholder value on the corporate mindset and replace it with more timeless values, integrity, fairness, social responsibility, and above all, fun. Joy at Work offers a model for the 21st century company that treats its people with respect, gives them unprecedented responsibility, and holds them strictly accountable, because it's the right thing to do, not just because it makes good business sense. More than any book you've ever read, Dennis Bakke's Joy at Work will force you to question everything you thought you knew about corporate success. Dennis Bakke was raised in Saxon, Washington, and graduated from the University of Puget Sound, Harvard Business School, and the National War College. He co-founded the AES Corporation in 1981 and served as its president and CEO from 1994 to 2002. He is now president and CEO of Imagine Schools, a company that operates elementary and secondary K-12 charter schools in 10 states. He and his wife Eileen live in Arlington, Virginia. PVG is proud to present Joy at Work, a revolutionary approach to fun on the job, read by the author, Dennis Bakke.
To my mother, Ruth Hawkinson Bakke, who taught me how to work. To Eileen Harvey Bakke, who walked with me every step of the journey. To Dave McMillan, who used my theories to build a workplace filled with joy. A note about the cover. "This is just like AES," exclaimed my then 12-year-old son Peter as I arrived home. He had presented me with a rubber band ball that he and his sister Margaret had proudly created. "See all the different colors and sizes of rubber bands? They represent all the different abilities and cultures of AES people." He had visited AES businesses in Argentina, Brazil, England, Hungary, Pakistan, Uganda, and the United States. He then bounced the ball off the kitchen floor. "Dad, it does what it's supposed to do. It bounces." Peter took one of the rubber bands off the ball and threw it on the floor. "You see, it doesn't bounce by itself. It only works when the rubber band is stretched around all the other rubber bands. That makes it bounce." I was amazed by and proud of his insight. He had captured much of the essence of what I was trying to create at AES. A group of people from different cultural backgrounds, with unique talents, skills, and aspirations, stretched and bound together to serve the world. Preface. My passion is to make work exciting, rewarding, stimulating, and enjoyable. Most books on organizational life and work focus on top executives and the strategies they use to guide their organizations to success. It is usually defined by financial results. This book is aimed primarily on the working life of the other 90 to 95% of people in large organizations. While economic success is also an important goal for them and their companies, the meaning of success goes far beyond the bottom line. For them, the crucial measure of success is the quality of their work lives. I have had the good fortune to help thousands of people find joy in their jobs. My dream, perhaps quixotic, but worth every last ounce of my energy, is to spread this joy to businesses and other organizations large and small. This is a book that celebrates the feelings of fulfillment that can be found in a humane and enlightened workplace. This sort of workplace does not preclude economic success. Indeed, there is ample evidence that a joy-filled workplace improves financial performance. But this is not a how-to book for executives looking to improve their stock price or beat the competition. This is a book for people who want more from their jobs than a paycheck and a benefits package. This book is for you if you are stuck in a miserable job, but motivated to do something about it. You are creative, capable, and responsible, and you desire a greater opportunity to use your talents and skills. A place just to make money is not good enough for you. A student in a management or leadership program who is not yet intoxicated by the exercise of power over people in workplace. You are open to an alternative view of leadership, a different sort of workplace, and a new definition of success for the organizations that you will one day lead. A high school or college student who wants to earn a living and have fun at the same time in a way that is compatible with your values and beliefs. A mid-level manager who feels trapped by a top-down, highly centralized organization. You know that your company is inhospitable to a values-based approach, but you are willing to suggest radical changes, even though you may be putting your job on the line. A government, business, nonprofit, or educational leader who appreciates the personal qualities of your colleagues and sees them as more than robots performing designated tasks. You seek a workplace that honors their talents and encourages them to strive. A president, director, or CEO who would be open to a different organizational model if it would bring joy to the people in your enterprise while still allowing your organization to achieve important business objectives. A scholar, researcher, or writer who understands, in your heart, the values and virtues of a joy-filled workplace. You need the courage to resist the blandishments, book contracts, consulting work, high-paying jobs that are routinely offered to people who preach ruthless efficiency and unstinting pursuit of profits. A priest, pastor, imam, or rabbi who is looking for a better way to understand and explain the relationship between faith and the jobs where congregants spend much of their time. Prologue. The idea of writing about the philosophy described in Joy at Work originated in the mid-1990s. I was CEO of AES, an energy company that by 2002 had plants in 31 countries, $8.6 billion in revenue, $33.7 billion in assets, and 40,000 AES people. In a dozen years of operations, we had developed a highly unconventional workplace culture and also achieved enviable financial results. Several family members, some close friends, a few business associates, and numerous students who persevered through my lectures suggested that I start putting what I was learning at AES in some publishable form. Joel Fleshman, distinguished professor of public policy at Duke University, was the most persistent, even offering to hire someone to follow me around to my lectures and write the book for me. I kept putting people off. Maybe someday, I would say, or I'm too busy being a CEO, a husband, and a father, or I'm not sure there is enough here for a book. While these excuses were at least partially true, fear of failure was probably the biggest roadblock. I knew that writing was difficult for me, especially writing something that was fresh and interesting, and perhaps even transforming If I could put my thoughts and beliefs on paper in a clear and convincing way. Most authors writing about business topics say, in effect, I did it, and here's how you can, too. This is not my purpose. I feel confident that I am on the right path, but I know I am far from my destination. This book is an extended argument for a simple proposition. The workplace should be fun and fulfilling. The case I make lacks the precision of science and the airtight logic of law. Instead, it is built on passion, experience, and common sense. These are the emotional and mental tools that guide us in our everyday lives. Many people have been on this journey with me. My brilliant and loving wife, my children, other family members, AES colleagues, and friends have provided insights, wisdom, and encouragement. Despite their support and guidance, I still make mistakes in plotting my route and staying on course. Undoubtedly, some of these errors have crept into this book. I am not a master of philosophy, theology, psychology, or sociology, but my wanderings have taken me into the territory of each. My lack of thorough grounding in these disciplines made it necessary to lead the AES Corporation in a way that was best described by my colleague Tom Tribone, one of the most creative developers of new business that we had. We try it out in practice and then see if it works in theory. Much of what might sound like a theory or philosophy in this book is the product of trial and error. I plan to write only one book, and I'm going to lay out everything I know. This is it. As my college football coach always said before each game, leave everything on the field. My brother Ray, author of several books on the urban church, often reminds folks in his writings and sermons that a point of view is really a view from a point. I have tried to write this book from the perspective of a God-centered world rather than a human-centered world, which is the vantage point of many of our nation's leaders in business, government, and academia. My understanding of work, business, and life is colored by my early years in the picturesque, isolated Nooksack Valley at the foot of Mount Baker in Washington State. The nearest small town was 30 miles away. All four of my grandparents had immigrated to Washington from Norway early in the 20th century. My dad never went to college. He went from job to job as a day laborer in construction or logging. He was a lifetime union member, a source of great pride to him. During most of my formative years, he was forced to leave home for 6 to 7 months each year to find work in Alaska. Seldom was he able to take home more than a few $1,000s a year during the 1950s and early 1960s.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.